Assalamu alaikum. So yesterday we continued with the topic of spot speed, and we discussed the measures of dispersion. So earlier we discussed standard deviation, then yesterday we discussed percentage of vehicles in the pace range, and what else? The 15th and 85th percentile speed. Okay. And the equation which we can use to calculate the standard deviation using these percentiles. And then we moved on to the concept of normal distribution. So we said normal distribution is the one where the frequency follows a bell-shaped curve. The frequency data follows a bell-shaped curve. We said spot speed is a normal distribution. We talked about standard normal distribution, which has a mean of zero, variance of one. And then we studied the concept of standard error or precision and confidence interval. And then we use the concept of confidence interval to come up with the equations of sample size. So these are the equations which we came up with. We were considering two confidence intervals, 95% and 99.7%. The first equation is for 95%. The second one is for 99.7%. And these equations are for calculating the sample size. So you need the standard deviation and error, okay, or the tolerance level to calculate the sample size, okay, according to the confidence interval. So we have this example here. They are asking us to calculate how many speeds must be collected. How many speeds means how many vehicles should be observed for speed, so that you have the true mean speed for this distribution within plus minus 1 mile per hour. With 95% confidence level. So 1 mile per hour is the tolerance level or the error which you are allowing in your observation, and 95% is the confidence level. And they also want to calculate the change in the number of samples if the tolerance level is changed to 0.5, from 1 to 0.5, and the confidence interval is changed to 99.7%. Okay, so in the book they have solved it in the form of this matrix. So you can see the values of tolerance level are changing from row 1 to row 2, and confidence level is changing from column 1 to column 2. Okay, and you can see that the values are written here, the whole equation. Okay. So when you're using 95% confidence interval, the equation has a constant of 3.84. You can see it here. And using 99.7% confidence interval, the equation has a constant of 9. Okay. Tolerance level is in the denominator. So you can see 1 in the first row and 0.5 in the second row. Okay. And 5. Now 5 is the standard deviation. Okay. If you look into the question, can you see the standard deviation given in the question? Is a standard deviation given in the question? And the answer is no. Okay, I told you the answer because some of you will keep on guessing. So the answer is no, the standard deviation is not given in the question. If you find it in this question, I will give you 100 BD. Okay, it's not given in the question. Why did we take the value of 5? 5 is like a default value, standard value, to be used if a standard deviation is not given. So if a standard deviation is not given, we use a default value of standard deviation as 5 for spot speed data. Okay, this is only for spot speed data. You don't assume a standard deviation of 5 for any data. Okay, this is for spot speed data. Standard deviation of 5 is assumed. Okay, then you can see the question is already solved. So I just we just explained the trends here. So if you see, when you go from column 1 to column 2, the values are increasing. The n values from between column 1 and column 2, the column 2 values are higher than column 1. Okay, both of them. Now, what's the reason? The reason is the confidence level. So when you go from 95% confidence level to 99.7% confidence level, you are basically trying to cover more population. Confidence level is basically how much population you are covering. This is your confidence level, right? If I covered more population, I will be more confident, right? So you want to cover more population, you should collect more values. I think it should make sense, right? You want to collect more, you want to cover more population, you should collect more samples. Okay, so that's why whenever you increase the confidence level, the number of values required, the sample size required will increase. Okay, then the tolerance level. Then you compare between row 1 and row 2. So when the tolerance level is decreasing, the number of values are increasing. So you can see the second row has higher values as compared to the first row. Tolerance level is precision of your data or the acceptable error in your data. So you are reducing the error. You are increasing the precision. You need more values. Okay. And this is what you you must have learned in surveying as well. So if you want, you can take one observation. If the precision is not important, but if the precision is important, you take repetitive observations. Okay, you take repetitive observations and you do it yourself as well, right? If I give you something to count, for example, through a miracle of God, because I will not do this. Okay, keep in mind, I will never do this. Okay, then for example, to make you happy, let's say I give you a bundle of cash, lots of money. Okay, and I ask you to count it. You will count it once. Okay. And then in order to make sure, you will count it again. Okay. And then since you know me, you don't believe that how come I gave you that much cash, you will count it again. Okay. So what you are doing, you are increasing your precision. You are reducing your chances of errors. Okay. So repeating the observation increases the chance of errors. So if you want to, decreases the chance of errors. So if you want to decrease the error, the E value, you should take more observation. More observation means more repetition, right? Speed is observed more times, so it will decrease your error. Okay, so decreasing the error needs more observations. Okay, then we come to the concept of before and after spot speed studies. Now, before and after speed studies is a concept which is used in many fields of traffic. So what do we mean by it? You have a before data, like you have data, and then you made a change on the highway segment, on the highway location. And after that change, you collected data again. So this is what we call as before and after study. Collecting the data before the change and after the change. Okay. Now, the change will depend upon what you wanted to achieve in the field. So here we are discussing in this chapter before and after studies to change the speed of the segment, spot speed of the segment. Okay, or spot speed of the location. So here we will discuss the concepts related to that, okay? But before and after studies are also done for accidents as well. Sometimes you want to decrease the number of accidents and you make a change for that. Then your before and after study will be for traffic accidents, but the procedure will remain the same. Collect data before the change, collect data after the change, okay? And same thing, you may do it for changing the flow rate as well. Changing the flow rate, changing the speed, changing travel time. Okay, so you do before and after studies for any of these reasons. Here we are discussing the before and after studies for spot speed. So you must have two samples, one before the change, one after the change. To do before and after study, we must follow two conditions in both the samples. Both samples must follow two conditions. The before and after samples must follow two conditions. Both samples are coming from normal distribution. Both samples are coming from normal distribution. Both samples follow normal distribution. I told you yesterday, how do I know that a sample follows normal distribution? How do we make sure that a sample follows normal distribution? Yes, I told you yesterday.
From the curve,
yes, good. So what should be the curve like?
The bell good. One, I think.
Sorry?
The bell one.
Yeah, the bell one. never heard it like this. The bell one, huh? The bell-shaped curve. Okay, so both samples, when you plot their frequency distribution, should be in the form of a bell shape. Tomorrow, I will also explain another method to know how the whether the distribution is normal or not. But up till now, what we know is the curve should be bell-shaped. Okay, this is what we know up till now. because looking at the shape of the curve can be tricky. It can be confusing for some people. So we have a mathematical method to determine it as well. But the main thing is both samples should have normal distribution. Okay, either you find it from the curve or using the mathematical approach, that's up to you. And both samples should have at least 30, both data sets should have at least 30 samples. Before and after, you should have at least collected 30 samples, at least. More is better. And this condition is also related to the first condition, because I told you yesterday, spot speed will follow normal distribution if you have collected enough samples. If you do not collect enough samples, then obviously you will not achieve the first condition as well. If you achieve less, if you have collected less than 30 samples, then there are chances that you must not have got the distribution as normal as well. Okay, so these two conditions must be fulfilled to apply the before and after study check. In the before and after study, we are looking to answer two questions. Before and after study of spot speed, we are looking to answer two questions. The first question is, did we achieve a significant difference in the mean speed of the before data and the after data? So you have a data set before, you have a data set after. You calculate their means. Okay, you calculate their means. And then you compare between them. Simple. You compare between them to see if the before and after sample are different from each other or not. Significantly different from each other or not. Okay. So now here the question is, how much difference is considered as significant? How much difference is considered as significant? Okay, and now I want you guys to participate. For example, if there's a difference of 1 mile per hour in the before and after sample, so let's say before was 40, after is 39. Is this difference significant? Is this a major difference?
No.
Okay, Ali says no. Anybody else who says yes? You can just raise your hand. If you don't want to speak, you can just raise your hand. Anybody who thinks 1 mile per hour is a significant difference in speed? Anybody? Ali says it's no. Okay. What about if I found the difference in speed to be 3 miles per hour? Is this a significant difference in speed? Yes, Huda says yes. Okay. Anybody else who thinks that it's a significant difference in speed? Anyone else? Okay. So here you can see the proof of my point. If I just leave it to the engineer that he compares between the two values and he decides whether the difference is significant or not, then let's say I have two engineers, Huda and Ali, in the team. Huda says it's significant, Ali says not significant. Who should I follow? Should I let them fight and decide on their own? No. Okay, you cannot do that. So we have to come up with a method, a mathematical method, a mathematical approach by which both Ali and Huda can agree that this is a significant difference, or they agree this is not a significant difference. I don't want to leave it to their judgment. I don't want this question to be left to the judgment of the engineer. Okay, in the previous section I did this exercise. One of them said 5 miles per hour significant, one of them said 10 miles per hour significant, and one of them said 15 miles per hour significant. So you can see how much is the difference in the opinion. So the point here is you cannot leave it to the opinion of the engineer to decide if the difference is significant or not. So we will go for a test to check this question. We will go for a test which is known as a Z-test. I use this term in the last lecture as well. So Z indicates what? What do we mean by the Z? I used it for a distribution, right? Z represents which distribution? Which distribution is represented with the letter Z or Z, if you want? If
you're familiar with that. Normal.
The standard normal distribution. Thank you. Standard normal distribution. So I showed you in the last lecture as well, you can convert any value into standard normal equivalent Z value by using this equation. Let me show you the actual equation. So you can see at the bottom, this is the actual equation for converting X into Z. So X is the value you want to convert. mu is the mean and sigma is the standard deviation. So value minus mean upon standard deviation converts the value to z. Here I'm checking what? I'm checking the difference between the two means. So I want to convert the difference into the z value. The difference into the z value. Okay. So x1 bar minus x2 bar is the difference of mean before sample, after sample. X1 bar is for before sample, x2 bar is for after sample. Okay. So I'm converting the difference between the mean values to the z value. Okay. Then value minus mean, I'm expecting the difference to be zero. So I'm being pessimistic. I'm being negative. That the difference, I achieved no difference. I'm assuming I achieved no difference. Okay, so this is my mean, zero. Okay, upon standard deviation. Now here I am taking the difference of two samples. If it was just one sample, I would have just taken the standard deviation of that sample. If it was just before or after, I would have just taken the standard deviation of that particular sample. But this, since these are two values, so I have to calculate their combined standard deviation, Sy. So Sy is calculated using this equation. Okay, so in this equation, S1 is the standard deviation of the before sample, N1, number of values in the before sample, S2, standard deviation in the after sample, N2, number of values in the after sample. Okay, so S means standard deviation, 1 and 2 is for before and after, N means number of values, 1 and 2 means before and after respectively. Okay, and same thing for X1 bar and X2 bar as well. These are mean values, 1 for before, 2 for after. Okay, now you calculate the z value from here, and I told you we have a z table. Why we insist on using the z value? Because z standard normal distribution is fixed, has fixed frequencies and fixed probabilities, okay, which are given in the form of a table. So once you convert the value into z value, then you don't need to plot or find out values on your own. You have a table from where you can find out the value for any z value. You can find out the basically cumulative frequency or probability, they call it the probability, for any z value. Let me show you the table. This is what we call a z table. This is a z table, okay? The values in the table are the cumulative probabilities, cumulative frequencies of the z value. The values which you see in the table are cumulative probabilities or cumulative frequencies of the z value, okay? And the z value will be inserted in the first column and the first row. The digit before decimal and the first digit after decimal will be inserted in the first column, and the digit after in the second decimal place will be inserted in the first row. Okay, let me tell you again. The digit before decimal and the first digit after decimal is located in the first column. Okay, and the second digit after the decimal is located in the first row. For example, if I have a z value of 1.14, z value of 1.14, and I want to find out its probability. Okay, what is the cumulative probability for z value of 1.14? So 1.1 will be taken from this column. Okay, and 0.04, the second decimal place is 0.04, right? 1.14, so 1.1 is done. Then we are left with 0.04. So 0.04 will be taken from here. Okay, so this row and this column, and you end up with this value. So the cumulative probability of 1.14 z is 0.8729 or 87.29%. 0.8729 or 87.29%. Okay, so this is the cumulative probability when the z value is 1.14. Now for before and after study, find out Sy, find out Z from these equations. Then you come to this table, find out the cumulative probability of the Z. Okay, the Z which you have calculated. The law is, the rule is, if that cumulative probability is 0.95 or more, then the difference between X1 bar and X2 bar is significant. If the cumulative probability of the Z value is 0.95 or more, then the difference between X1 bar and X2 bar is significant, otherwise not significant. If the cumulative probability of Z value, calculated Z value, is less than 0.95 or 95%, then the difference between X1 bar and X2 bar is not significant. Okay, so the difference to be significant, probability of the Z value must be at least 0.95. Okay, then, so this is the first question we have to answer. The first question was, did we achieve a significant difference in the mean speeds? And if the answer to this question is yes, then you move on to the second question. The second question is, was the required or the desired reduction achieved or not? So you wanted to reduce the speed. Reduce it to a specific value. Most of the times we have a value in mind that this value was not working earlier. The initial value was not working earlier. If you reduce it to this much value, then it will work. The accident will reduce or the flow will be better or whatever. So what is that value you wanted to achieve? Okay. So did you achieve that value or not? For answering the second question, we will use the concept of confidence interval. How to use it, I will show you in the example. Okay. But keep it in mind, this question will only arise, or this question is only to be answered if the answer to the first question is yes. What was the first question? Did we achieve a significant difference? If you say yes, then you go for the second question. Did you achieve the required value or not? If the answer to the first question is no, then the answer to the second question is automatically no. If obviously you wanted to achieve a significant reduction in the speed, that's why you made the change. So your required value, you know, already has a significant difference from the initial value. So if you did not achieve any significant difference, how can you achieve the required value? For example, initial value was 50, you wanted to achieve 40. Initial is 50, after the change, you wanted to achieve 40. Maybe you achieve 42. Maybe you achieve 42. 40 to 42 may still be significant. From the Z value, you may find that even 42 has a significant difference from 50. So the first question is yes, but maybe this 40, obviously you wanted to achieve 40. Okay, so you have achieved a significant difference, but it's not what I was looking for. I was looking to make it even lesser. Okay. So if the answer to the first question is yes, you go for the second question. If the answer to the first question is no, second question is already no. Okay. Let us do an example here. We'll do a couple of examples. We have done a before and after study to check the effectiveness of a new speed limit. So I told you in one of the previous chapters as well, that one of the objectives or one of the aims of doing a spot speed or speed study is to find out the effectiveness of the speed regulations, right? So they have changed the speed regulation at a particular site so that they can achieve an average speed of 60. So that they can achieve an average speed of 60. Now they're asking, is the new speed limit effective? And if it is effective, did they achieve the speed limit of 60 miles per hour or not? Or did they achieve the required speed of 60 miles per hour or not? They wanted to make the average speed to be 60 after the new speed limit. Go to the notebook. Data. And we need these equations, so let me put the equations as well. Okay, so basically in these equations we are looking to calculate S, Y and Z, right? And mean the standard deviation and the number of samples and the mean values which we have. Okay. So give me the values of S, Y, and Z, D here.
Standard deviation 1.0 for it.
1.0
for it.
1.0 for it. So 1.05. Okay. Z D.
Two point one nine.
Okay. Then you go for the Z table. Okay. So in the Z table, 2.19. So 2.1 is here. This is 2.1, so in this row, and then 0.09 is here. Okay, so the value will be this one, 0.9857. Okay, now what was the law? What was the rule? This value should be how much? For the difference to be significant, the probability should be how much?
0.95.
This is 0.98, right? So it is more than 0.95. Okay. So the answer to the first question is yes, we did achieve a significant difference in the speed. Okay. In the after sample, the difference in the speed is significant. Okay. Now, they wanted to achieve average speed of 60. In the after sample, after the new speed limit, they wanted to achieve the average speed of 60. Now you look at the after sample, the average speed is 63. Now you tell me the answer to the second question. Did they achieve the average speed of 60 miles per hour here? Should be easy, right? They wanted to achieve 60, and the average is how much? 63. So, did they achieve 60 or not?
No.
No. Okay. Now this is very simple, but obviously, like I said, I keep on saying we don't want to make your lives easy. Okay. So any easy answer is not acceptable. So your answer when you said 60 is not achieved, 60 is not achieved for these 60 drivers basically. This is not the complete data set, right? This data set only belongs to these 60 drivers. Okay. So if you are giving me answer no, you are giving me answer on the basis of these 60 drivers. So you're not considering the other thousands of drivers who may drive on that location. Okay. So your answer cannot be taken on the basis of this sample. Okay. I must base my answer. I must relate my answer to the complete population, Okay. So I will calculate confidence interval for this sample of drivers. Okay. So for these drivers, I will calculate confidence intervals. So confidence interval, and in before and after studies, we use 95% confidence interval. For before and after studies, we use 95% confidence interval. Okay. 99.7% confidence interval is not used. Okay. So 95% confidence interval is calculated in this manner. I've already showed you in the previous lecture as well. So I'm just writing the equation here, 1.96e, where e was s divided by root of n. So obviously I cannot put root here, so I will just write n, and I will put the power here. So for the after sample, the mean is 63, standard deviation is 6, n is 60. Give me the confidence interval here. How much is the confidence interval?
Sixty-four point five.
Okay, and these are miles per hour. Okay, 95% confidence interval means you covered 95% population. So 95% of all drivers are in this range. According to normal distribution, central limit theorem, 95% of all drivers are in this range. Okay. Your required value is 60. Your required value is 60. This value of 60 is not in the range. Okay. So 95% are in this range. So any value which is out of this range has less than 5% chance of being achieved, because it's 95% range. So the remaining is how much? 5%. So any value which is out of this range has less than 5% chance of being achieved. So 5% is considered as negligible. 5% is considered as negligible. Okay. So to achieve a value of 60, there is less than or negligible chance. So we will say that 60 miles per hour average speed was not achieved in the after sample. 60 miles per hour average speed was not achieved in the after sample. Okay, this will be our conclusion. Okay. So yeah. So this is, you know, this is how you perform the before and after after study. First of all, calculate the Z value to check if the difference is significant or not. If the difference is significant, then you go for the second part, which is to calculate the confidence interval. And if the required value is in the confidence interval, you will say that there is a high chance of that the value is achieved in the after sample. If it is not, then you will say there is negligible chance that the required value is achieved. Okay. Let us do another example. So we have before and after study data again, and they want to find out the effectiveness for a series of rumble strips, okay, which are installed before a toll plaza. Okay, so toll plaza is something which you must have seen on the causeway. When you're entering the causeway, you have to pay a tax. Okay, so the station where you pay the tax is a toll plaza. Okay, so it's a tax which you pay to drive on that road. Okay, so we call it a toll, don't call it a tax. Okay, so they put rumble strips before the toll plaza so that when the drivers are coming close to the toll plaza, they reduce their speed. They want the drivers to reduce their speed at 40 miles per hour while they are on the rumble strips. What are rumble strips? Tell me, has somebody driven to Riyadh or Makkah or Medina in Saudi Arabia from the causeway? Somebody went there by car, maybe to Riyadh or Makkah or Medina from here. Anybody? Anyone? Obviously before COVID, maybe. Anybody who has traveled by car to Saudi Arabia and went, you know, ahead of the mom in these areas. Anyone? No one? Huda? So if you go into the main highway, which is connecting the mom to Riyadh, or any main highway on Saudi Arabia, you will find these check posts. Okay. Normally they are very good. They don't stop you. Okay. But they want you to go at very slow speed. So before these check posts, you will see these rumble strips. Okay, so sometimes they are in the form of these small speed humps. Okay, so they are small, but 2-3 together. So you have 2-3 speed, small speed humps together just before the check post. Okay, I think they may also be using it in these big hotels and the important locations, you know, like military locations and so on. Anyway, but before the check post, these are very common in Saudi Arabia. You're on the main highway, you come close to a check post, you will see these small speed humps which are 2 or 3 or 4 together. So the idea is to reduce your speed. Okay. Sometimes they are also in the form of these small cat eyes. You know, the cat eyes which you have for the lane marking, the small objects which you have, trapezoidal objects, reflectors. You call them reflectors, right? We call them reflectors. Reflector is the more common term, right? So these reflectors which you use for cat eyes, sometimes you put them across the road, again in lines together, so that again the driver will feel the vibration and he will slow down. Another example of rumble strip is these yellow lines before the intersection, not the yellow box. Okay, not the yellow box, yellow lines before the intersection. Okay, so they are also sort of a rumble strips. Again, they will, when you are on them, they will create a vibration and you have to reduce your speed. Okay, so these are like rumble strips. Okay, so they have a toll plaza. Again, going back to the question, they have a toll plaza. Before the toll plaza, they want to reduce the speed. And how to reduce the speed? They put a series of rumble strips. Okay, so they have collected the before and after data. And again, we have to answer the same two questions. Did we achieve a significant difference? If yes, then did we achieve the required value of 40 or not? So here in this question, they wanted to achieve a value of 40 miles per hour. Okay, so again, we need S, Y, and Z, D. How much is S, Y here?
Zero point six seven,
and Z D.
Four point zero three.
Okay, now the second step was to go to the Z table. Okay, and find out the probability. Now, if you go to the Z table, you see how much is the maximum Z value in this table. Tell me. Maximum Z value.
3.49.
Okay, you got 4 point something. Okay, so how can I find out the Z value, the probability of this Z value if it is not in the table? Okay. Now, I said these values are cumulative probabilities. These values are cumulative probabilities, okay? So you see when the Z value is increasing, the probabilities are also increasing, okay? You go from the top left corner of the table to the bottom right corner, you see the values are increasing because the Z values are increasing, okay? Now, what is the maximum cumulative probability you can have? What is the maximum percentage of cumulative probability you can have? The maximum percentage for anything is how much?
One
or 100%. Okay, so anything which has which is more than 3.49, any Z value which is more than 3.49 has a cumulative probability of one. So when you go beyond this table, when your value of your Z value is more than the value given in this table, that means you have achieved a cumulative frequency of one, cumulative probability of one. And obviously you cannot do more than one, so there is no need to put it in the table. Okay, so any value which is more than 3.49 has a cumulative probability of one. Okay, so in the table they have already included the last possible value before one, which was 0.9998, and after that you can only achieve one. Okay, so for 4 point something, any whatever value you have got, the cumulative probability is one. Okay, so the question is, did I achieve a significant difference in the mean speed before and after? What is your answer? If the cumulative
yes.
probability is yes, you achieved a significant difference in the cumulative probability, in the mean values of before and after sample. Okay, then the second question, did we achieve the speed of 40 miles per hour? Did we achieve the speed of 40 miles per hour? Not. For that, I must calculate the 95% confidence interval. Take this. Put over here. So, okay. Tell me. What is the interval here?
Forty-one point eight.
Okay, and I think this is the upper value.
And 39.8.
Okay, so now you see the other example as well, in which they have actually achieved the required value. The required value is in the range. So required value in the range means what? That I have 95% chance that samples collected on this site after the rumble strips have a mean speed of 40, because 40 is in the range. Okay, 40 is in the range of 95%. So there is 95% chance that the samples collected on this study site after the number of steps may have a mean speed of 40 miles per hour. Okay, so if they're required, again the rule is, if they're required in the range, you say that there is a high chance that we have achieved the required value. If it is not in the range, the chance is negligible, and then you answer the second question is no. Okay, do you have any questions? Okay, this is the end. Yeah, I think I took some extra time in the first section, so we are stopping here. Do you guys have extra